Hello, Malto's Mountaineering Masters, and thank you to Toby Wood, for that malt mention introducing Whiskey Review 600, well, Ralfy Review 619, about whiskies I buy at auction. Right, so the title is Whiskies I Bought at Auction over the last few years. And the reason for this video vlog moment is really to give you your bearings should you decide that you're going to buy whiskies and other spirits from an auction house, whether it be a local auction house who generally auction all sorts of stuff and just happen to have a few whiskies or wines or cognacs or whatever in with the lots. Alternatively, it might be a specialist whiskey auction if you're across in Europe or in some parts of the world where they are actually allowed, and you choose to kind of go and spend a day at an auction house, looking at what's on display, looking at the estimated prices that they'll sell for, and seeing what people are actually bidding, and importantly, who's bidding, and working out why. It's something I used to do in the old days, way, way back in the mists of time. Yes, the Scotch mist of time. I used to sit in an auction house in Glasgow, and I wasn't buying anything. I was there to watch, look, and learn, to see the lie of the land. Now, fair dues, many years ago I missed in quite a few bargains. There was one in particular, 3 bottles of Bonahabin Old Acquaintance, which went for £100 plus commission. Well, I missed out on that one, but you know, swings and roundabouts. Since I have been bidding in auctions, and generally it's online auctions that I'm bidding now at, and just for the record, you will not see me bidding on old-aged Talisker's, Macallan's and Ardbeg's. You will not see me bidding on Port Ellen's and Karuizawa's. I'm not in that market. I'm not prepared to spend megabucks at auction. I'm basically looking to mop up a few of the whiskies that are overlooked by collectors and institutional investors because they're not considered important and they're not really considered interesting enough. So here's a good example. I'm going to go through each bottle one at a time and I'm going to tell you exactly why I bought it. And I'm going to give you a rough idea what I paid for it, and explain just what attracted me to them. First of all, we'll start with this. This is a bottle of Long Row Rundlets and Kilderkins. 11-year-old single malt from Springbank Distillery. It's the peated version. And the reason I bought this and I paid about £65 for it was that I bought a bottle while it was still available in the shops. I opened it, really enjoyed it. In fact, the whole Rundlets and Kilderkins range from Springbank are excellent whiskies, all of them. And by the time I went back to the shop to buy another one or two bottles, they'd completely sold out. As a result of which, my next best option was either to phone a few friends and see if they had some that they were prepared to sell, which was unlikely, or actually bid at auction. So in fact, the very next auction, online auction that came along, I bid on a bottle and I got it for about £20 more, plus commission, of course, than the going rate. But in my opinion, it was still worth it. Careful, of course, to check the sealant, you see, the seal on the bottles. That's one of the most important places to check that someone has not just opened the bottle, enjoyed the contents, filled it with something else, and then resealed it. There's two style of fakes that can appear at a whisky auction, despite due diligence and vigilance by the auctioneers, who do have experience and who generally, depending on which auctioneer it is, show some responsibility in the matter. I'll leave it at that. Moving on. But kind of reassuring that ordinary, inexpensive auction whiskies are not going to make mega bucks for the forgers, the professional forgers. Therefore, they will concentrate on the high-end stuff. And I'm going to come back to this in a couple of videos' time, because I really want to dish out a big warning here for buyers, you know, malt mates, enthusiastic, individual buyers. Never mind the institutions, they can look after themselves. They can take the losses. But there's quite a few high-end fakes in circulation, and I want you to be aware of it. Moving on. An old bottle of Teachers from the 1980s. This particular one, 12 years old. Age statement, Teachers. Wonderful. Original seal. That's what I'm checking for. Check that everything else follows up the shape of the bottle, the label. This is in good condition, by the way. And I bought this because Teachers traditionally has been a good blend, which has deteriorated recently because it no longer has the high proportion of single malt content that it used to have, primarily Ardmore. With all bottlings, the chances are quite high that you are getting, particularly when it comes to this Teachers, that you are getting a superior version to what you can buy now. And that is one major reason why people are now spending a bit more to buy old blends at auction. And I'm going to come back to this shortly in one of the other bottles here. All of these bought at auction for drinking. Here we are, a Michel Couvreur, independent bottler, age statement on it. I'll probably open this and review this for you. I noticed a few of the collectors were interested in this. You could see the style of bidding that was going on. You do follow the patterns. Always look out for the patterns. Comes with observation over time. But you see at the top here, the seal is damaged. Now, when you get bottles which have got ripped labels, are water stained, perhaps a chip out the glass, perhaps a dent in the seal, so long as the seal's not actually broken, you will find that the serious collector is looking for pristine editions or pristine versions as much as possible of the whiskies for their collection, and therefore any sign of obvious damage is immediately putting them out of interest in bidding, which lets the drinker have more of a chance of getting the whiskey at a better price. Okay, here is another fine example, still available, by the way, in the shops, but this is Black Bush from Bushmills. This is sherried Bushmills. And I've really noticed recently how young and two-dimensional the casks are. My last taste of Black Bush, frankly, was very disappointing. I think it's gone downhill. It's a supply-demand thing in the way things are going with availability and quality of casks in use in the market generally today, which means that to get the delicious Black Bush that I love and remember from tasting 10 and 15 years ago, my opportunity to buy a period version of a whiskey which is no longer as good as it used to be is at auction. So here we are, this is a 1980s, early 1990s version of Black Bush. Checking the seal, yep, little bit of slack, but not too much, important. And of course with screw tops, always give them that little clockwise twist, not too heavy handed, because they will loosen in time, which leads to evaporation of the spirit and reduction in the fill level. That is an excellent fill level. If the fill level drops down in the bottle, what you've got to be aware of is the spirit that's probably being lost. Therefore, the strength of alcohol in the bottle as the neck fill level goes down is reducing. and changing the dynamics of smell and taste of the contents, which is why if you're buying a whiskey for drinking, I do not generally recommend that you go for bottles with low neck fills. Here's a beauty. Totally overlooked, and I don't know why. This is 35-year-old Glen Grant from... who's it from? Excuse me a second. Who's it from? Where's my steampunk? What am I doing folding up my glasses? Never mind this. Single malt, Lonnach whiskey, Duncan Taylor. That's who bottled it. Independent bottle of Duncan Taylor. Now, Duncan Taylor, legend has it, wasn't keeping an eye on some of their old whiskey, and they discovered that some casks of really old whiskey had actually dropped below 40% volume alcohol, which means they could no longer sell them as a whiskey, because by law in Scotland, Scotch whiskey must be a minimum of 40% alcohol by volume. Simples. So what they did was they ended up with old whiskies which they couldn't sell as single cask whiskies. So what they'd do is they'd get a lower strength old whiskey and they'd combine it with one or two casks of higher strength whiskey of the same age and put it out as a small batch. And this is a classic version of that. 35-year-old Glen Grant. I paid about £70 for it, including commission. This was a few years ago, about 3 years ago, when you could pick up these little beauties that had been overlooked because everybody was looking at Port Ellen and Talisker and Ardbeg in dumpy bottles, etc. Again, a beautiful whiskey. I know that when I open this, it's going to be a very nice experience. And finally, this absolutely dog-eared bottle of liqueur from the Drambuie Whiskey Company, who make Drambuie liqueur. Well, this is another liqueur they've made called John O'Groats. And it's been sitting here in the bothy for about a year, gathering mould, gathering dust, getting increasingly dishevelled and scabby. And what I'm going to do is, somebody, I'm just going to bring in a corkscrew, my first aid kit, my recovery kit. I'm going to open this and just nose it and taste it on the spot at the moment I open it. Liqueurs tend to be looked down upon because they contain sugar. However, I reckon this is from the 1950s, maybe early 60s version of liqueur, John O'Groats. It wasn't a great liqueur, but it will have some old bottle effect. And part of old bottle effect is that sugars break down slightly over time in bottles and become a little more monosaccharide than disaccharide. So there's a certain sweet complexity in the sugar content. So it'll be interesting to try this. So here we are, £60, £45 for this, £65 for this McCouvreur, £45 for the Black Bush, £70 for the Glen Grant, £30 for the... In fact, the teachers... was £25 plus commission. Oop, thought something was tipping there. £25 commission. So, really roughly a little bit more than the going rate for a modern bottling, but really interesting. Importantly, when one opens, it doesn't matter whether it's a malt or a blend, when one opens these old bottles and you spend time smelling them and tasting them, you really start to get your bearings on what the old bottle experience is and how it can change if it has been tainted, been in bad storage, been subject to temperature fluctuations in storage. You can tell when you're nosing it and tasting it, generally if it's been tampered with, if something's wrong, you get a subconscious message that, hang about, there's something not quite right here. what is it? Old bottles of whiskey can be subject to bacterial contamination and cork tainting, which can render a prominent cheesy note, which flattens out the complexity of smell and taste. In other words, it's a soiled bottle. They do exist. When you come across them, nobody's to blame for this. It's just the passage of time, and it's the chance you've taken as someone buying these whiskies. More people now getting into the whole Scotch whisky thing as a hobby, as enthusiastic amateurs, as members of whisky club or just whisky circles. At some point, someone is going to pick up and bring along an old bottle of whisky or an old bottle of any spirits, and you're going to pour a glass and ideally share it with the modern version and really spend your time with it to get the fullness of the experience. And it's such an education. What you discover purely through the sense of smell and taste, maltmates, is how whisky has simply changed over the years. Whisky now has never been more available. It's decent stuff, but some of the real magic moments lie in the past with these old bottles. And you look for yourself. That this isn't the expensive high-end stuff. I'm simply not prepared to pay the premium and get caught up in the Ponzi speculation that is high-end whisky investment and prestige collecting. I'm not going there. Simples. I'm sticking to the fun stuff. And with the fun stuff, there's some fantastic malt moments and blend benefits to be encountered. So I will come back to these over time. Probably starting with this little fat, chubby chap here. And before too long, I'm just going to do a memory lane whisky tasting for you, in which I share the smell and the taste of whiskies and other spirits from bygone years. And I talk a little bit about that age and what affected the taste and what affected the smell when they were actually produced when they were. There you go. I'm Ralphie. I hope you've enjoyed this little alternative malt moment. I will be back again shortly with Whisky Review 620, which will be a review of a Glenfiddich. Yes, an older Glenfiddich. An affordable, available, but older Glenfiddich. But I'm going to conclude with this review by saying, at auction, don't forget, there is the buyer's premium. When you are bidding on a whisky, whether online or physically or by phone at a traditional auction house, what you pay, the hammer price, is not the full cost of what you've bought. That will involve commission. With some traditional auction houses, the commission can be 20% or more sometimes. If they've got additional costs, like registering and storage. But with the online auction houses, they don't have the premises. Everything's virtual. They, instead of shelves, they have high detailed photographs for you to examine. And generally, their commission is 10, maybe 15%. But it shouldn't be that much more. So there you have it. Now you know, just sharing part of my journey with you, because it helps, doesn't it? Experience, you can't whack it. Not even with a big stick. See you soon, malt mates.